Hey everyone, and welcome to Comics from the Multiverse, the DC Comics podcast from Mailed Fuzz. I'm Peter, and I'm joined, as always, by Matt.
Hey, what's up?
And unfortunately also here, in a red shirt to go with his red hair, Connor's welcomed us here to in his presence.
Why is my intro always insulting? Every time.
Because it's you. Connor, if it makes you feel better, I'm wearing my Rebel shirt from my Smuggler's Bounty box.
Such a cock.
All right, let's swiftly move it. So we talk about DC Comics, we talk about the comic books that came out this week. This week's show, we're going to be talking about Action Comics, Detective Comics, Wonder Woman, The Flash, Batgirl, Teen Titans, Batman Beyond, Deathstroke, and Hal Jordan and the Green Lantern Corps. Typically Blue Beetle's on this week, but I didn't quite get around to reading it, and I'm the only one who is reading it, so...
It's been a hectic week on our part with all the other TV stuff. Blame Iron Fist and its shittiness.
Yes, Iron Fist from Netflix delayed everything we had going this week, including reading our books. It was a bit of a crunch getting everything in time.
See, I haven't finished Iron Fist. I haven't picked it up since last week. And, terrible. I read all my books. So, priorities.
You're also the biggest Iron Fist fan among us.
And that's why I haven't finished, because my wife doesn't want me to be in a depression all week. So, yeah.
Oh, dear. No, it's absolutely... It's basically garbage. I'm going to say it. It's flat-out garbage. But you can go check that. We've got all 13 episodes reviewed individually with spoilers. Me and Connor waded through all that shit. And we tried to be positive at the start. We tried to be optimistic. But as it went on, it just got worse and worse.
There was about the halfway point. We just snapped.
Yeah.
Connor got top 10 drunk while watching one episode. So,
all right. So that's what's coming up in the show. Plus a plug for all the Iron Fist reviews that are up.
Yeah, of course. It's called cross promotion synergy. I learned it from Disney.
So before we even get to books, though, we do actually have some news this week. Some interesting news, some exciting news, and some.
The war of jokes and riddles.
I know we had that last week.
Oh, I know, but you said exciting, so I went opposite.
well, first things first, we have a couple of one-shots announced which are leading into the big event that's coming in summer, which I'm assuming now is coming in August, since these one-shots are announced for June and July. We're getting one in June, one in July, so it could be the end of July we get the actual event, but I'm going to just assume August at this point. Mm-hmm. So we're getting, this is going to be co-written by Scott Snyder and James Tynion IV.
Oh, that's good. That's a good team.
Yeah. Definitely. So we have... We have Dark Days. They're both called Dark Days. The first one is Dark Days, The Forge, issue 1. And then the one in July is going to be Dark Days, The Casting, issue 1. Now, both of these sound like they're related to metal, which makes sense, because I believe the title we know of the event right now is Batman Metal. Yeah. Although, apparently, at one point he did say that the Hawks were going to be integral characters. And when you tell me metal, and you tell me Hawkman, I'm thinking Nth Metal. So,
Man, so we get Batman with Nth Metal.
oh, Matt's going to hate that.
And as soon as you said the Hawks, and for the audio listeners, I wasn't sighing at the Hawks. I was sighing at that idea that Batman with Nth Metal bat wings.
I'm
kind of love it.
I'm cool with it for a one-time thing.
Just for the event only, yeah. Yeah. But if it was a permanent addition after that, ooh, no.
Yeah, so both of these, well, honestly, we don't have the solicit for the second one yet, but I'm assuming it'll be the same as the first one, but $4.99 going to be annual size in terms of pages, I think, so they're doing these two one-shots, and that's going to lead into the big thing that's coming next, the big event that's from Snyder and Capullo that they've been talking about. Related to this... And there's a cover for that first one, by the way, if you want to check it out. Interesting. But related to this, they're actually going to be announcing what this event is, presumably with some other tidbits. Next Sunday, April 2nd, they're at an expo, and they're announcing this, but they're also going to live stream it on the internet. So this is very reminiscent of the WonderCon panel that we got last year for Rebirth's announcement. I doubt it'll be as big or as long, but... Well, that'll be interesting, so you can watch that live. We are going to do a bonus little extra sort of one-shot episode just to talk about it, so we don't have to add it into the following week's episode, and because by the time we get to the following week's episode, it'll be like 6 days old. It'll feel ancient at that point.
Yeah, no one will care by then.
So we're going to do a little bonus episode for that. How long that'll be and how much we have to talk about is completely dependent on what they
give us. Depends on what they give us, doesn't it?
Yeah, because they might give us just one little thing. They might give us a whole host of things. Like, we're getting the event, but it'll spin out into this and that. And here's the GSA.
I'm fully expecting a different title, though. No way Batman Metal is what it ends up as.
Yeah, I can see them having a better title than that.
Batman Metalcore.
I'm wondering if it will even be called have Batman in the title. I feel like it'll...
Batmetal.
But once you put Batman into the title for an event, it feels like you're focusing in just on the Batman world rather than...
Yeah.
These events are typically things that affect DC.
Oh, like the Justice League movie. Oh, I see.
But by all accounts, this, as much as Batman's the central character, it sounds like it is Rebirth related and it's reshaping things and...
You know,
there'll be more to it than that.
I am positive on one thing. I really like the Justice League interaction in Snyder's Batman during Endgame. When they all somehow, you know, they got Jokerized, and you see like Batman not wanting to take down his friends, like it wasn't like this. I've been waiting years to do this. It was Matt, Clark.
Is this just building up to a dig at the Snyder movies? It feels like it is.
No. Scott, I'm talking about Scott Snyder. That's.
Oh no! I know, but I mean, just the way you're going. Like, oh, he doesn't want to take down the Justice League members. He wants to avoid the conflict.
No! I'm just talking
about.
It's just
too easy to draw those parallels.
Yeah.
It is. I'm just saying, as someone that's not big on Batman, I like that Snyder has a relationship with the rest of the DCU. So it would be cool to see how he interacted with them, because he's really only written Batman. I mean, he did Superman Unchained, but it was fine.
It was just hampered by delays.
I never finished.
It's not that memorable either. Like, it's kind of a
I went back and read it after the fact, and it was much better in trade rather than 7 months apart.
I think I got to issue 3, and I just kind of like, it's only okay, and I'm not feeling it. And
like, it would have been a perfect arc for Superman, not a miniseries. Like, it just
that's fair.
But my whole point on all of this is if it is going to focus on the DCU, I hope it's better than All Star has been. You know, so
I
no offense, Connor. I know you're enjoying it, but me and Pete.
I am, but also Tynion's involved, and he's integral to the Bat family in general right now.
Joe's
so
funny.
I have nothing to be afraid of.
I remember a few years ago when we would have said, "Oh, thank God Snyder's there to keep Tynion because Tynion hadn't proved himself yet." Whereas now, post Detective Comics, we're like, "Oh, thank God Tynion's there to keep Snyder in check."
Yeah. There was a point where Tynion's best work was the backups in Snyder's Batman.
Yeah.
I mean, for as good of a writer that Snyder can be on Batman, I think Tynion's the same level on the Bat family. Like, this is the guy that's made me care about Clayface. So, but I'm interested to see what it has to be. And I'm not surprised that it's so Batman-focused, being like the first summer event. It should feel like a blockbuster. And if you want as many eyes on it as possible, you do focus on Batman.
I think it probably just neatly comes out of the whole... Because we're getting the button, which Batman's core to the investigation of what's going on, so maybe it'll just naturally lead from there, and that's why he is the central, because he's the one trying to figure things out, and it spins out of that. But we'll have more. We'll talk more about that in that special episode next week, because obviously we're going to know more then, so we'll save more speculation for when we actually have some info to go on. Another thing coming in June's solicits, there's a bunch of issue 25s hitting, and... It's worth mentioning that they're all going to be special anniversary issues. So there's going to be about 6 or 7 books that, for one issue, for issue 25, they're going to be 40 pages at $3.99 instead of the usual number at $2.99.
I think we can expect this every 25 issues. Because obviously Action did with a 975. Yeah. And so I think every 25 now will just be a anniversary size.
And I'm cool.
And that's fine.
I'm cool with this. The only problem I have with this particular example is that it just so happens that 5 of them hit in the same week, which is
it's an extra $5 on your budget.
It's a little bit annoying in that sense, but otherwise I'm cool with it. It's fine. I was just going to say, for the record, the books that are coming out in June that are issue 25 and we'll have this like extra priced issue are Batman, Superman, Green Lanterns, Green Arrow, Wonder Woman, The Flash, and Aquaman. So
So it's not all of them, right? It's mainly the main double shippers and or the twice monthlies. But you're getting more pages. It's not like they're just doing the whole bait and switch. Oh, look at all this extra content we're just going to throw in there. You know, Action 975 has proved like, oh, we got a really cool Paul Dini backup. That was worth the extra dollar.
Yeah, we did it in Detective 950 as well, right? And that was worth the extra dollar for the backups.
It was. I think it's fine. I think the only downside with this batch, like I say, is that a lot of them are hitting in the same month, never mind the same week.
It's just the way they staggered the starting, isn't it?
So you're getting, I think there's 5 in week 3 and then 2 in week 4. And then there should, theoretically, there should be about 3 in July as well. Nightwing, Hal Jordan, and I think one other book in July. I think Justice League maybe is the other one. They should all be getting an issue like that in July as well. So it's cool. It's just awkward that they've all bundled up at the same time. But otherwise, and I think what I'm going to get to in a minute actually is a few of them are actually starting kind of prominent arcs. Batman 25 is the start of the war, Joker and Riddle, so they're kind of using it as a launching pad for the next arc. Yeah. We did get solicits this week. Now, I was a little bit more strict with what I brought in to talk about. Because there was a few part ones I ignored because either not all of us read the book or it didn't sound like an interesting part one. So I've only got 3. And we already talked about War of Joking Riddles last week. We already talked about that one. So I've just got 3 that I wanted to highlight. 3 sort of first parts of new arcs that I thought were interesting for various reasons. First one is Detective Comics 958. Which, by the way, I want to point out that Detective... I think... Was it this issue? What was this issue of Detective? 953. 953, I think we're only a couple away from what Action was at when it started at Rebirth. And it's just, I just want to point out how close they are numbering. It's less than a year apart they are.
About a year or so, I think.
Yeah,
Action's done the weekly thing more, so it's gotten, you know, for a while there in like the 50s, they were doing Action Comics weekly. So, you know, and I don't know if Detective's ever done that. I think Detective's just been routinely up until Rebirth.
Oh god, I don't know. I mean, let's be honest here. We're talking about 70 years of history here. No doubt they've done various things at some point or other that we just.
I mean, the
about.
Fact that they're so close in numbers means that they've probably both done it at different times and more or less caught up.
Yeah,
because they're really, really close. But so Detective Comics 958. It's going to be Intelligence Part 1, and the reason why I'm pointing this out is this seems to be the start of the Asriel arc that's coming. That was hinted at in 950. Cool. I'll read you the blurb. Asriel has found a new home in Gotham City. Unfortunately, someone from his old home with the Order of St. Dumas has found him. The Order has unleashed a bizarre new evil on the world, and it's convinced it must destroy Jean-Paul Vallée. So, Asriel arc coming. That's pretty cool. Starting in June.
Again, never thought I'd say I'd be excited for an Asriel arc.
But here we are.
Keep going, Rebirth.
Brave New World. The Flash issue 25, which is going to be Running Scared Part 1. It's also worth mentioning that 24, which is at the same month as the prelude to this arc, but I picked the Part 1 because I thought this was more interesting to read this one. So, Running Scared Part 1. When Eobard Thawne murdered Barry Allen's mother, he killed a piece of the Flash's past. Now, Reverse Flash is back to kill Barry's future. The Flash's biggest storyline yet begins as he is pushed to his limits and his secrets are laid bare in a chase through time itself. I also want to point out this one has a fantastic cover where it's like Reverse Flash is inside the Flash and he's ripping his like face off to reveal himself. It's glorious. Check it out.
It sounds like a fun arc.
It does sound like a fun arc.
Oh, fun.
Oh,
wow. So crazy, crazy man.
Old Eobard. He's a classic for a reason. And then the last one I wanted to point out is Green Arrow issue 25. Again, another anniversary issue. It's called Broken Arrow Part 1, and there's no John Travolta or
Christian Slater.
Thank you. I was like, God, I was blanking and missed a robot
also,
there.
Also, football great Howie Long, one of the henchmen.
Naughty, I work for.
Yeah.
Broken Arrow Part 1. Hopelessly divided over Oliver's role in the rise of Star City, Green Arrow and Black Canary do the unthinkable thing and break up. While Dinah starts a resistance movement in the former Seattle underground, Ollie's been driven out of the city he sacrificed everything to protect, and it's only the beginning. The next major phase of Green Arrow begins with this oversized anniversary issue.
Do you know what's crazy about this?
Mm-hmm.
The way Green Arrow's kind of been heading lately, it feels like this could be the end of a run. Like, this could be where it's wrapping up.
Mm.
But this seems to be like, no, that's going to be... And then a whole other thing's going to start. And it's like, this is like almost act one instead of to the end of the movie.
That's what I was going to say. It's like act one.
And George, what I love, that we're hitting issue 25 of these books, and the writers are showing no signs of leaving anytime soon. It's like, no, we're still right in the middle of a run.
I mean, really, the only books that have really had anything is Superwoman.
Mm-hmm. Which, by the way, actually on Superwoman, I actually looked up who, Kay Perkins is writing it. I looked up what I knew that name from, and I'm actually more excited for her now. Because
why is that? Where was she?
She wrote that last Supergirl arc in New 52, but the school.
Oh.
Oh.
Mm, interesting, right?
It is, because the last arc set up kind of a supporting cast, and we know from that school arc that writer can deal with ensembles. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know, that's cool. So I'm interested. What were you saying, Connor?
I was just saying, is that the only writer change that we've had? I can't think of any others off the top of my head.
Yeah,
because that's a full year without a single with one writing shift.
And when it comes to these double shippers, that's basically an omnibus worth of books.
Yeah, you got 2 years worth of stories essentially.
Yeah,
on a regular schedule, and that's really impressive, especially given that obviously at this point in the New 52, the cracks in the editorial were beginning to show, and things were going all over the place.
And that was with single shipping. Like, they were only 12 issues into a lot of books.
It's about this time when it started to fall apart on the teams.
I still hadn't learned my lesson on reading Teen Titans and Superboy. I was still going strong.
Oh God, Lobdell's Superboy! What a fun time.
Ooh.
Oh dear. Let's talk about books. Let's talk about comics. And first up this week, we have Action Comics 976, which is the final part of Superman Reborn, written by Dan Jurgens and art by Doug Mahnke. So, this was good. This was good.
It went down pretty much how we expected.
And that is almost a negative that I think sort of pulls it down a little bit, in the sense that it just kind of did what we thought it was going to do. And it was good. It was all well done. And it did the thing we wanted it to do. But it did. It played out exactly as we thought it might.
It's hard to complain, but it's hard to go, oh, it blew me away. Because it did exactly what it set out to do. We knew what it was going to do because it was so well-seeded. I was like, okay, cool, we get it. This is just, you've got to do this issue.
Yep, that's Superman and Superwoman. That's Superman and Lois merged with their New 52 counterparts, and their timelines have been merged so that everything is in continuity and everything just sort of is merged to make sense. The only thing that doesn't quite make sense, going by this, everything happened in both kind of thing, if we're still in the timeline from New 52, it does mean that John's now in the same boat as Damian, in that how was there enough time for him to exist?
Well, no, because there's the 10 years that have been stolen, right? So it was like, okay, something happened in those 10 years, and then it crunched, and that's when the Clarks split.
Well, yeah, but we don't have those 10 years back yet.
Well, no, but John's an anomaly. That's the point. He happened in those 10 years, presumably, but he's an anomaly. So
No, but Connor, they say it's all merged at the end of this issue, that it makes sense now. The memories of both have aligned.
Yeah.
So,
but that still doesn't mean that there's not something strange afoot.
Of course there's still something strange afoot, yeah. There's still 10 years missing, but what I'm saying is it puts John in the same boat as Damien, and the timeline doesn't add up. All the characters around him are supposed to now remember things as if he was always there. Right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
It's the same, you said, it's the same with Damien, but with Damien...
Yeah, but Connor's arguing me. So
but Damien's is like... See, this is the thing. It depends when they splintered, right? With these two Clarks. Because they have complete separate lives.
See, but this, at this point, they didn't. Everything got rewritten.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
Connor,
wiped out New 52, brought in the pre-Flashpoint stuff, right?
Yeah.
And Connor, it's not like they were both living the same life and then it splintered and then they went their own ways.
Yeah.
When New 52 happened and they splintered, their entire history got splintered.
Right. So in a meta way, this is them going, hey, we should have never split up Lois and Clark and tried to make them cool 20-somethings.
Yeah.
Instead, let's do what we should have done and made them, you know, 30-something parents of a 10-year-old.
Well, that is the only thing, though, is they feel de-aged, and that's fine. If they wanted to do that, they did that.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what makes John an anomaly. But that's the only thing I mean about putting him in the same boat as Damien, where it's the same thing with Damien, where so Batman was supposed to be Batman before he had sex with Talia, and Damien was conceived and born, but the whole timelines might have happened in 5 years, kind of thing. That's all I mean.
Damien was accelerating a test tube.
Sure.
That's true.
Sure. This is more efficient.
She had so many of them, though, too.
Yeah. Like especially in the Batman Inc. stuff, where Heretic, that was a fully grown version of Damien. Like, so I just assumed that they were all sped up, and our Damien was sped up a bit as well.
New 52 are bollocks. That's not what I actually
meant.
Yeah,
exactly.
Well, yeah, well,
but it's also what's cool, too, is that because I'm going back and reading the Damien solo series, you know, because I want to know how he got his bat dragon, Goliath, you know.
Oh, by the way, that's what I was thinking. Remember when I got a name wrong in Titans? And you said I was getting it wrong from a Marvel character, which was really insulting, by the way. No, I was calling him Goliath because of Damien's pet, not because I was thinking of some Marvel character. I was calling Mammoth Goliath.
Oh, okay.
And you were saying, oh, you're thinking of a Marvel character, and I was like, how dare you? How dare you say I'm thinking of a Marvel character?
Yeah. Filthy casual. Marvel.
I'm joking, people. Yeah. Was it Matt?
Yeah. Well, no, just, and it's good that we have Damien's kind of backstory and art going through there, written by Tomasi. So now he can do kind of the same with John and build on that, making it, you know, flashbacks to him growing up and whatnot.
Here's how I'm looking at this merger here, right? I think for the people who for some reason think of New 52 Superman as their Superman and were annoyed when Superdad came on the scene, for them, this gives them an easy write-off, saying, oh, it's technically still him. He's equally part of him. Whereas for me, all I'm reading from it is, no, it's still really our Superman. They've just de-aged him a bit, and we've wiped out the fact that it was a duplicate. And we're just back on track.
Yeah.
That's what it feels like.
My one problem with this is the whole Lois and Clark relationship and her getting pregnant.
Mm.
And then 10 years down the line, there's a Superboy, like, with Superman. Like, it doesn't do a lot to help keep a secret identity in Metropolis.
Well, yeah, but that's the other thing, though, is that this resets kind of what we can think of as classic Superman, because now the whole secret identity being out of the bag is gone.
Yep.
Yeah.
Now Clark can go back to the planet, so.
Because Lois would never out him, even if it was to save things. Like,
yeah.
That always just felt so hollow in the New 52. And if New 52 Superman is your Superman, I'm very, very sorry. You need to go read Mark Waid's Birthright and just go from there.
I think I'm just...
All the bad New 52 stuff.
I think I'm just sorry for you in multiple levels. Sorry that you only read Bad Superman. Sorry that you clearly have some sort of problem in your life, that you're turning to these weird stories to fix them. I mean, I don't know.
Yeah. It was a good issue. I thought the aging thing was a little bit weird, because all the promo stuff of the upcoming Superman stuff, he looks a bit older still than this. So I don't know if they just drew him a bit young accidentally looking at this.
Yeah, it may just be inconsistent.
I mean, I'm looking at the big splash page that has the time fixing itself.
Yeah.
And you look on the bottom left corner with Jimmy. Jimmy looks like he's 14.
Yeah, he does.
So, I mean, think they were trying, but I just caught that right now.
He has a really creepy grin on his face as well.
Yeah. Well, that's his best friend's kid. I mean...
Obviously, I think the more exciting stuff was the Mixie started talking about, oh, you're messing with reality. You two finding each other again and try to fix it because the power of love and whatever. You fixing this, he's going to notice. The one who orchestrated everything and messed all this stuff up is going to notice that you're kind of forcing things to fix themselves. He's not going to be happy. All that kind of stuff was kind of obviously intriguing. And then Oz was kind of reiterating the same thing again at the end. Yeah. With less fear in his voice, admittedly. Mixie was scared shitless of Manhattan.
Now, here's the thing. Do we think that Oz is going to be revealed to be a hero keeping Manhattan in check? And that's why he's doing this? He's kind of letting the table still be set so Manhattan doesn't notice from Mars? Or do you think he is working in conjunction with Manhattan to keep this going?
Well, it depends how you look at it. Like, is he taking people off the board, as it were, and imprisoning them because he's worried that they will, like Superman kind of has, force like a recollection or mm-hmm. the timeline to maybe try and recorrect itself because, you know, maybe Tim would eventually inspire that or something like that. And is he trying to keep the board looking the same so that Manhattan doesn't notice and try and intercede again? Or
I think for me that makes it seem like he isn't a villain and is working against Manhattan is he took Mixie, so Mixie didn't mess things up. He's like, no, you'll get in the way. And it's like you might draw his attention.
That's what I'm thinking of. If he's just, because we all, if he is Ozymandias, which we all kind of guess he is, he has his own plan in play. And I almost say if he's working against Manhattan, he wants to do it without Mixie messing things up. Mm-hmm. You don't want to draw too much attention, right? Like if you're a burglar, you don't want to attack a house with a dog because it's going to make too much noise, you know?
Yeah, so. I think for me it's too much that they say he looks so villainous with, you know, the ominous hood and the hiding
the
face.
Yeah, but
he's taking Tim.
Yeah, and I just feel like that's set up for a swerve, maybe.
Yeah, exactly. It feels kind of too obvious, doesn't it?
It could be.
Maybe
it's more murky than that. Maybe he's not being as evil as Manhattan, but he is out for his own reasons, his own gain.
Yeah. Well, that lines up with Watchmen, because that was the whole story of that. It was kind of Ozzy versus Manhattan, and Ozzy manipulating Manhattan.
That's it, though. If he is trying to face against him, and he does ultimately turn out to be heroic, I'll buy it to a point, mm-hmm. because I feel like he is the sort of person who plays the long game. Like, why is he taking these people off the board? Is he ultimately doing something? But then again, why is he imprisoning them and not just telling them and say, you need to stay here for X reason?
Yeah. I mean, that's true. It reminds me of the Monitor in Crisis.
Yeah. At the very least, it makes him cold. Like, even if he's doing it for the right reasons, it makes him cold and not...
Well, absolutely. Right. And that's indicative of the Watchmen universe, too. Like, it's all... So, I don't know. I'm grasping things.
That said, though, I did love the way it teased him at the end. Because the way he'd be like, wait... Is this fixing things enough for him not to notice, or will he? And the panel goes from like Earth to the Moon, and then the Moon to Mars, and you're like,
Mars. Yeah.
Is he just
or
up there?
Him. And I asked, and it says, is it Superman who has the final say, or him? And I like that he's putting Superman on level with Dr. Manhattan. You know, like...
I like the idea that he, like... Oz isn't sure if Manhattan's going to be pissed at someone's altered reality, like when it wasn't him, like behind his back or whatever, and he might be pissed about it. So,
yeah. Although, what if this is all just a massive story and it's Martian Manhunter? he's stuck on Mars.
I'm not sure it's that Manhattan would be angry, because angry isn't really his thing, is it?
Okay,
I think
sure.
It's more that he'd see things were changing, and his curiosity would be like, what's going on there? And that's when he peeks his head again. Everything that he does is kind of because he can. He's never really emotional about it.
Okay, sure. Anger was probably just a poor word on my part. I didn't really mean necessarily pissed off at it, but just in the way that he'll see it happening and go, wait, why is this happening? This isn't right. I'm going to go and fix it.
Yep. And it also could be the inverse that Ozzy has, you know, set up Dr. Manhattan to take the fall, right? And it's really him just manipulating things. And if Manhattan notices, he could undo it all. And that's what he doesn't want. You stay on Mars building your clock castle.
Okay.
You know?
So Matt's making a bold prediction. End of the event in 2018, in the summer, because it was a 2-year plan. End of that event is going to be Manhattan revealing that he's actually the good guy. Oz has been manipulating him. And at the end, he will fix it and reset the universe for everyone.
No, not reset.
Not reset. Reset's a poor choice of word, but you know what I mean. Like, alter it. Give the 10 years back.
There's so much, there's just so much going on here on so many different levels. And this is, again, what I had a problem with New 52, is everything was just so shallow, and it didn't seem like there was long-term planning and even guesses, whatever. It was kind of like Superman Reborn was the New 52 in a nutshell, where it's like, oh, we kind of see where this is going. And that doesn't necessarily mean it's bad, but certainly within New 52 wasn't good. So, you know, and I think Reborn just came in and undid everything and set things back up where it needed to be. And that also begs the question, too, if there was never New 52 Clark and Lois, then what's up with Superwoman? Right? Because how did Lana get powers if there was never
New 52 Clark? We have Aftermath issues next month, and Superwoman's one of those. I fully expect we're going to get that. It did say, when it said it was being rewritten, though, when Oz said it was being rewritten, he did mention everyone connected to them is affected by it.
Yeah.
So we'll see how that plays out, obviously, in all these Aftermath issues. Looking forward to him showing up in Supergirl as well and all these other things. It should be interesting. But that's Action Comics. End of Superman Reborn. Fun little event. I think it was a lot more focused on one specific thing than we maybe thought it was.
Yep.
Yeah, because obviously we went in knowing that this was obviously the outcome, but I think we expected it to be more than just this. Ultimately it was just this.
Because ultimately it ended up just being mixy for a lot of it. A lot of it was about Mixapetalik.
Yeah.
But I'm not complaining. I like Mixapetalik. I haven't seen it in a while. So
I think my only problem with the story in general is it still feels like this is course correction. This is still fixing the universe from the New 52's mess. And it's like, okay, we're a year on and we're still having to do an entire month of stories just to fix rather than tell its own story.
Connor, that just shows you how big the mess was.
Oh, it does. And it's something that like it had to be done, but it's annoying that we had to spend a month, as good as it was and enjoyable as it was, this could have been its own story entirely different instead of fixing shit that didn't need to be broken in the first place.
But it's still, like you said, I am happy I read it. I'm probably going to get the trade. I'm going to mount these issues with the Frank covers in order on my wall here because it looks so great. So, you know, even though if it was a fix and it was like them cutting the Gordian knot because it's just so knotted up that you can't but destroy what came before, then that's fine. I've experienced, as a Superman fan, I've experienced far, far, far worse.
Yeah.
And a waste of my time than a fixing.
Yeah, so, and Jurgens and Tomasi did manage to make it enjoyable, even if it was ultimately just fixing.
And that Deany backup with Mixie and playing with all the different mediums.
That was fantastic, yeah.
Exactly, and we got that because of that. So
that was great. So, all right, there you go. That's Action Comics. That'll take us on to Detective Comics 953, James Tynion IV writing, and Christian Duce and Fernando Blanco on art. So this was the next part of the League of Shadows. And we got more stuff with Cassie Kane and Sciver, and we got the Shadows kind of enacting the next step in their big plan to take over Gotham, as well as I love the opening scene because Montoya like brings Gordon back from his vacation. He's like, "Oh, I want the weekend to play golf or whatever he says."
And he's in his Hawaiian shirt.
Yeah. Gordon in a Hawaiian shirt is my favorite thing.
Yeah, but she pulls him onto a helicopter and she's like briefing him what's going on. And when he gets on the helicopter, Batman and Batwoman are there to brief him. And it's like the police are after him. But Gordon, of course, knows that Batman's not behind this.
Yeah.
So there, I like that relationship still persists and that it's all in secret. But so the gist of this one is that Cassie is still kind of obsessed with Sciver. She's watching the footage and she has a really great heart to heart with Clayface, who sort of talks about how he used to not be able to portray his feelings and communicate well, so he started using other people's words, and he hands like a Shakespeare play, and he's like, you know, I'm supposed to keep you here, I'm like babysitting duty, but like it's not really that unbelievable if you could get past me. So
this is probably my favorite bit of the issue, actually, this interaction. I think, like Matt said at the start of the show, the Tynion's made us care about Clayface, and that you can put Clayface in a room with Cassie and have this interaction is just fantastic.
Yeah, that's great. And she goes out, and Batman catches her, and Batman's like, you shouldn't go running off to Sciver, and Cassie's like, well, it's time to fight then. And Bruce doesn't fight back. He like tries to just kind of stop her, but he, of course, gets the shit kicked out of him, and he's left hanging off a gargoyle as Cassie runs off, who she then fights Sciver, and I mean, it's not Times Square because it's Gotham, but it's essentially Times Square.
Yeah. We had to come up with a Gotham name for that. It sounds like Times Square. Crime Square.
Crime Square. There you go.
There you go.
Crime Square. And they have this fight. One of the things I love about this fight scene, though, is when they're talking to each other, there's these panels where they do this effect where it's all the lights of all the billboards and like screens behind them out of focus. Mm-hmm. And it gives it this
it's
really,
gorgeous, isn't it?
It's great. It gives it this very, it feels almost like they're in Tokyo kind of thing. I'm thinking of like Lost in Translation almost.
Yeah, like
head.
A neon yeah. washover.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It looks really cool.
And then I love when they actually go into the fight, everything disappears. It's just white background. None of that matters anymore, that background. It's just the fight.
They're hyper-focused.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's an emotional fight because Cassie's like fighting to prove herself, but she won't fight to kill. And Sciver's like, if you're not going to fight to kill, don't bother fighting me, girl. Like,
she's not even fighting at all. If you look at it, she's just blocking the blows. So I don't think she actually. Yeah. I don't think she lands a single. I don't think she strikes out at all, actually. All
right. So you guys are familiar with rope-a-dope, right? In boxing.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. I would love if that's how this ends, is like Cassie just basically defeats Sciver without having with only needing to land one blow, right? And she rope-a-dopes her, just constantly blocking, and then basically does to Sciver what she did to her in the first issue, where she like nerve pinched her and shut her down. Like, I think that could be really cool.
That could be fun. And meanwhile this is going on, League of Shadows shows up at the Belfry, beats the shit out of Clayface. There's just clumps of clay lying around when Batwoman shows up later. And then Batwoman gets stabbed, like full-on stabbed, in front of her father. Because like, the assassin's like, yeah, Sciver told us to make sure you could see this. And then stabs Kate.
And make it slow.
Yeah, it's like, brutal. It really feels like the stakes are like turning up. Like these are a formidable foe, and they're doing all this stuff. Oh, and
they feel completely different than the League of Assassins. Like, making them their own distinct thing, I think, is really cool. Because I rewatched Batman Begins earlier this week, or last week. I can't remember when I watched it. But they use them interchangeable there, and I think it's easy to do that. But I think Tynion here making them distinct organizations is really cool.
Yeah. And Batman hears Alfred be distressed over the comms, so he rushes off back to the Batcave. He sees the screens, he sees Clayface's beat, he sees Orphan's down in like Crime Square. I'm keeping that, sticking. And he sees Kate Kane's been stabbed at the Belfry, and he's like, no. And then we get the big cliffhanger, the issue is Ra's al Ghul is in the Batcave to see Bruce.
And his henchman, who I haven't seen in forever. I don't know if he was just created for the animated series, but I think his name's Abu. Ubu. I can't remember. But
I love that. I mean, it might not be, but I love the idea that he's here because Sheev is a common enemy. And
That's what I get. He knows exactly what's going on. He's gone, all right, Bruce, come on. We need to do this. We need to sort this out together.
Yeah. Where's that little tyke who beat me up and his cousin a couple of weeks ago?
Yep.
My little troublesome grandson. But no, I thought it was a really good issue. I thought everything was like heightening the stakes, and something as simple as like bringing Gordon in to like have him in the loop of everything that's going on, so that there's someone on the force other than Montoya that's like on their side, and it felt like everything was like heightening. I'm loving this arc. This arc's been really, really good.
Yep.
Yeah. This whole series has been fantastic.
It has.
This is the type of Batman I love to read. Like, there's multiple characters going on. You feel Gotham as a whole, and then you throw Ra's al Ghul in there, and with a common enemy, it's fantastic.
That's great.
And it is. It's Ubu. I remember that. It was one of my favorite toys as a kid. That's why. But
all right, let's move on to Wonder Woman issue 19. Greg Rucka writing and Liam Sharp on art. This is the next part of the Truth storyline, and for me, this was maybe one of the weaker issues of the book. Not because it was bad, just because it was kind of, it was just kind of like connecting this issue and the last issue like together. It was like the characters were finding out things.
It was a bridge.
Yeah, that we mostly knew. Sort of everything was regrouping. Like, they got Diana out of the mental hospital, and there were some sweet moments in there. And the best stuff was definitely when they go to see Dr. Cyber. They're trying to figure out where Barbara Ann is, and they're trying to figure that stuff out. And Dr. Cyber's like, this is your fault, Wonder Woman. You did this to me. You brought the gods to our Earth, and that got me killed. That got this happened, this happened. Veronica's daughter's faceless because you brought the gods to our world. And
yeah, but again, that's just how faulty God Watch is looking at this, when it's Trevor landing there that brought her there. So what made Trevor crash?
That's
I think that's the ultimate, you know. Because I'm sitting here reading, I'm going, well, no, that's not true at all. And again, this arc is called Truth. And the truth is a very subjective thing when you think about it.
Actually, Even Dr. Sciver brings up that I've been messing with you for years, because we've seen that the start of that in the God Watch story, which is really cool.
The last issue.
But she's like, oh, right, are you the one who's like making me think I've been going to Themyscira? And she's like, you're giving me too much credit. I can't do that.
Yeah.
It's like, yeah, who is behind that? Because I don't think that's necessarily related to Rebirth. It feels like it's a more specific to Wonder Woman thing. But I could be wrong. I could be wrong.
Yeah. I mean, well, I'd hazard a guess it's Wonder Woman.
Yeah.
Because we know Hippolyta's trying to reach out to Diana, because now we're getting those scenes set on Themyscira, and it seems like there's only a small band of Amazons there, right? Like, it seems like a very close-knit group, not like what we saw early on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
I really like that page where they see the gods in their animal forms. Yeah.
Mm.
All right. So who is the big deer? The stag. Yeah, because it's not Artemis, because I know Artemis is, she was the huntress god, and her thing was the doe.
Yeah, that's what I was just thinking.
And she's working with Prometheus anyway, so let's ignore her.
Which one's Artemis's brother?
Apollo. That's who I thought.
It doesn't really fit for stag, does it?
No. Because I can look and pick the other ones, and that one just, unless it's Hephaestus, but I've never heard him being...
You
do much better with this stuff than I do, Matt, so I don't think you're going to get much help out of me.
Hephaestus, I'd imagine, would have to be a bull, surely.
Yeah.
But
I tell you what I liked in this issue.
Anyways.
I liked Etta getting angry that they've got Barbara Ann again, and being like, you took Barbara Ann away, and she's like about to go into a punching fight with a hologram, and like she's been held back, and I'm like, it's a hologram, Etta, calm down, calm down.
She'll just let her swing. That would have been the great comical moment, you know, you swing and she just goes straight through it.
Yeah.
Because you put that much force into something, you can't stop your body going with it anyway.
Yeah. No. So that was good. Obviously, they find Sasha's body from the Checkmate lady.
Yeah, so
I remember from her.
Yeah, I was say so. She's from Checkmate, right?
Yeah,
that's like her whole. Okay, and that was another Rucka title, right? That he was writing. Yeah. So he's pulling stuff.
Sometimes they'll do stuff like this in comics, especially rookies. They're not with Ferdinand as well. Where he'll pull out this reveal of someone, and I'm like, have they mentioned her recently? Like, am I supposed to know really specifically who that is? And then I remember she was from Checkmate, and I'm like, oh, this is Rucka pulling someone back in again from one of his old
own previous stuff. Yeah,
and it's like okay, fair enough. It's okay also, that I don't remember that well. Right.
This made me really like Ferdinand as a supporting character. The hug that he gives Diana, and just you could tell how much he cares for her. And then when he starts to get upset when all the stuff's going on.
Oh, what about the doctor when he sees it's actually Wonder Woman and he's like, but you're actually what you and Steve's just like, yeah, keep this quiet, thanks.
Hassel, Steve has become a great character here too. Whereas in New 52, he kind of was. They tried to make him the Nick Fury of the DCU, and it just didn't work. Him just being like a supporting character, he's almost like Diana's Gordon. Almost, where they have this partnership. It's a little bit different.
If Batman and Gordon were making out on top of the rooftops, sure.
How do you know they're not?
He definitely works better in relation to just Wonder Woman than he does as a bridge to the DCU as a whole, like he was in the New 52. Yeah.
And it's cool, like when you see Gordon interact with Superman or Wonder Woman, and I kind of want that out of Steve Trevor. Like when he shows up, you know, something different is going on in the book.
I think for me, though, what it is Diana, she's an envoy, she's an ambassador, so she doesn't need someone like Steve to bridge, which is why he always kind of felt redundant in that role.
Yeah.
Mm.
But this is much better.
So, of course, there's one quick scene with Kale, and she's like, God Watch, take care of things, put the hit out on Diana. Operation God Watch is in full effect, which leads to the ending when they leave Kale's like headquarters or wherever at the end, where they've been snooping around and found Dr. Sciver. They attack Wonder Woman. Wonder Woman fights some of them off. She like does a cool thing where she goes into a van and like crumples it. But then a sniper, who she doesn't see coming, shoots her from behind. And we see the bullet go right through her chest. And we end with her like bleeding out on the floor. That's obviously the most exciting part of the issue because it was like, oh shit, Wonder Woman just got sniped.
I didn't see it coming. Like that's. Did you guys?
Well, I mean, you have that shot of the sniper, and a couple of times it's looking through the sky. It's like, is that doesn't seem like it's going to do much.
What I mean. I thought she would, at worst, it would bounce off, or she would, you know, we need a really cool bracelet deflection.
It's kind of flexible with Wonder Woman, but the way I would typically treat her in terms of like being bulletproof. Well, she has to defect them with her bracelet, so she's not completely bulletproof. Mm-hmm. So the way I see it is, a sniper is a high caliber piercing.
It's not that I didn't think that it would affect her. It's just that I didn't think it would catch her by surprise the way it did.
Exactly.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Like I thought, just her, she'd see it coming. You know, you just always expect the hero to do that, really, don't you, in these stories?
And that's where Rucka's so great at pulling the rug out, because every Rucka series I've ever read has a moment like this where I should see it coming. I read enough comics, but he does it so well.
I love how the background for that shot is just that gorgeous orange glow all around it.
I think as well what it does is it makes Godwatch a formidable foe. It makes them feel dangerous because they just snipe Wonder Woman.
Yes.
Yeah. It was a good issue. I when I say it's like one of the weakest, like say the arc or whatever, it's just because it is very much dealing with information that the characters are just kind of putting together now. That has mostly been stuff that we've been in on for the most part, but certainly enjoyable. That'll take us on to The Flash, issue 19. Joshua Williamson writing and Jesus Merino on art. And this, I basically divide this issue into three segments. There's the fun segment, which is Boomerang, Flash, and Kid Flash being like tied up with these like Aussie gangsters, and they've got their
Weavers,
their guns, and Kid Flash uses the boomerang to like cut all the weapons up, and it's just a really fun lot of jokes. And then you have the more kind of emotional middle section where Kid Flash finds out his father's died in Suicide Squad because Boomerang tells him. And he runs off, Barry runs off after him, and in an effort to connect and try and make him feel better, Barry reveals who he is. And it was a great moment because you hear him say his name and you're like, he's taking his hood down. He's going to turn around and he's going to see Barry. And you turn the page and sure enough, it was Barry. So really, really cool.
Put a smile on my face. And then you get to Wally's reaction, which that smile turned quickly to a frown.
It was heartwarming at first until he started asking about Iris. Like, does Iris know?
Yep.
And then he got really upset that she didn't. And like, you're a liar. This is what Daniel did to me. This is...
And he's justified. I want to be like, hey, Wally, stop being a little shit. Mm-hmm. Like, he cares a lot for you and your aunt. But at the same time, him being like a 15... year old kid and the life that he's led and been lied to his whole time, it all makes sense. Not like it's not out of anywhere, you know, out of nowhere.
And Wally runs off, and that's kind of that. And then of course the final part of the issue, which is, I mean, the issue was good anyway, like all that stuff, you know, it was fun, and then it was emotional, character beats worked well, but then the final part of the issue, which is there to set up the button, but we go to Iron Heights. And Eobard Thawne, not only does Reverse Flash break out of his restraints and he's like full, you know, classic yellow Reverse Flash, he says, I remember being killed by Thomas Wayne in Flashpoint. I'm going to make his son pay.
Yeah. I'm going to teach his son a lesson. Yeah.
This is exciting.
There was the little tease earlier on, you know, as they were sitting out in the Australian desert and they were talking. Yeah, that's the one, the Outback. But yeah, they were talking about, but Barry was telling his story of what Eobard did to his mother in the past, and you just get like the shadow of him in over the sky running across. It's just like he's infected, he's everything. He's just there, and he's coming.
Oh man, Eobard remembering Flashpoint though, and presumably remembering the time before it, if he remembers Flashpoint.
Yeah,
like, it's super exciting.
This adds another wrinkle into Superman being reborn. And the whole Flashpoint stuff, because Flashpoint's the reason why John was born, yet if John was born in this rebirth era, right, because they went back and fixed time and memories, then what the hell is going on with Thawne? And Thawne's already a time traveler, right? So now this sets up alternate realities and whatnot. Mm. And this is why I love Flash, for all of this murkiness.
As a super, obviously, we've got another... issue before we get to like the button stuff, right? But this is clearly setting up the button. And actually, as much as we thought, oh, they're going to investigate and that's going to be the inciting incident, I actually kind of like that. Oh no, they've set up another reason why they're going to look into things, because Eobard's going to show up. And obviously,
and mention it, presumably. Yeah.
And obviously, Batman's gonna be like, "Oh shit, I need a speedster, Barry! Barry, can you come and like protect me from Eobard Thaw? And he's trying to kill me. Thank you." I'm being facetious, but like, you know, I like that. That's kind of it's given us a new end to the storyline rather than just the one obvious thing, which is cool.
I had a big old stupid grin on my face when I got to that last page and see Thaw break out. And just him mention Flashpoint.
Like, Joey reminds me of, do you remember in Flashpoint when he showed up? It was the cliffhanger at the end of issue 4, I think it was. Just the second last issue when he finally showed up.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, look at what you did, Barry. Just look at what you did. It just reminded me of that. Like him showing up and being like, oh, I remember this.
I think what I love about him is he always has the power. He always has the knowledge. And he is that demon knowing things that, that others don't. And that's what makes him dangerous beyond just the speed.
Yep.
Yeah. No, it was fun. And like I say, not to gloss over the early stuff of this shit, because I really liked, I thought Boomerang was a lot of fun, and then he, like, Boomerang has this thing, like a lot of the rogues do, where they're not actually that evil, so when he actually kind of chokes up, like, telling Wally about his dad, it's like, he can tell he cares enough, and he's not a dick to, he cares that he's hurting this kid's feelings, he's not just throwing it out, which is nice.
And it makes me wonder about his own son, you know, because we had Captain Boomerang and Wally's run when John's had him and he was the second one. So it just makes me wonder if that's still kind of continuity. Like he has a son that he's abandoned and this,
it would play into this nicely, wouldn't it?
That's the sort of thing they could just decide to do. Like, because if he has abandoned him, it's not like they had to have had him mention him before. So.
Right.
Yeah.
So it works.
I thought generally the art was still bugging me a little bit in the first half.
I noticed it. I liked it because I liked the art in the last issue as well. But I did notice that when it got to the emotional like demasking, it changed quite a bit at that point of the issue.
Yeah, and obviously Giadomenico's done some of the art. I think he just does the ending.
He does the certainly the first page with just Wally and Barry after they run off. I'm sure it's him because it definitely changes there.
Yeah, it does. As soon as it goes to changes to when it changes to nighttime, something in the art changes, and it's just it is completely different. But in that first part, while I'm not as big a fan of it, the page I did really like is when Wally's going around with the boomerang. I really liked that it followed the boomerang's arc, and that really gave it a sense of energy and momentum because you could follow it around through the boxes.
Yeah,
pretty cool.
Yeah, that was cool. So that's super fun and then emotional and then a really cool big end. And this was a great issue of Flash, I think.
Yeah, it was.
That'll take us on to Batgirl issue 9, Hope Larson writing and Chris Wildgoose on art. This is the next part of the Son of Penguin storyline. And we have another app that these companies are pumping out.
I can never go to Burnside, ever.
Too many apps.
I would go on a punching spree worthy of the Hulk.
Honestly, do you know what my favourite moment of this issue might be? It's actually when she goes to her library thing where she's like teaching the kids how to hack, and the little girl's like showing, oh, I've got this dog app, it's Doggo or whatever it's called, and you do this, and they explain, oh, it's data mining, they're keeping track of where you go, what sort of things you look into and all that sort of stuff. And I love that she goes off, she stops talking, and she goes and writes down a bit of paper, and then holds it up and says, are they listening to us? It just, do you know what it felt like? It was like little Ron Swanson, just like, are they listening to us? It was so much fun. I love it. But no, she's helping out a friend who's having a fight over adopting / getting a kid with a partner, and she's got a paper she's supposed to write, and she's having struggling focusing. Meanwhile, she's still trying to look into Vic Form, where Penguin's son is like sort of working out of, and she goes to like a masquerade ball with him briefly, and they have a little bit of a moment. But of course, the big thing is at the end of the issue when she goes during the masquerade ball, she's like, "Oh, no one's at his headquarters right now. I'm going to go and snoop." And we get these wonderfully comical bowler-hatted henchmen attacking her, and she's like, "Wait, I know who these belong to." And then obviously the actual Penguin, Oswald Cobblepot, the wonderful bastard that he is there.
I kind of wanted to be a hipster villain, like not Penguin.
You just wanted to punch a hipster.
That's my MO for everything in life.
I have to admit, though, I do appreciate the bowler hats. When that first bowler hat henchman shows up, I was like, oh, I'm kind of digging this.
Do you know what my one problem with it is? I wish they'd gone full James Bond and, you know, thrown the bowler hats and they'd been all like, you know, blades. that's what this needed, just to be, just to really be perfect.
He throws a shoe.
We only got like 3 pages of them so far, so you might get that next issue.
I'm hoping so.
Make that next issue. Art's still good. That's Wildgoose. Well, he's not obviously
Albuquerque.
Thank you. He's not him. I think he's doing a good job. Again, the facial expressions are really emotive, which is really nice.
Yeah, I didn't notice any of that weird pop art backgrounds this issue.
That's true. Yeah, there was none of that. And again, like I say, the scene with the little girl was probably my favorite. But there was good stuff throughout. I liked her doing her whole trying to focus thing, especially when she starts imagining like Nightwing and her other friends and stuff, like saying, "Ah, what are you doing? Stop paying attention to this. Go and do this." No, voice for Batgirl's doing pretty well. But no, I'm curious where this is leading. Like, what is, other than that he wants to like take down Batgirl, and she establishes that the whole dog app is like just a ploy to try and keep track of her.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, what is his end game actually? Is he just trying to take over the town? Is he wanting to be like a new crime boss like his father is, or like?
Yeah, I mean. I don't think he's going to end up being like Penguin, being son of Penguin. But I definitely think it's a new... Because if he's data mining, that means he's getting information on everybody, and then he can end up being like a broker, kind of like the calculator was.
Yeah, you know? It feels a bit too much of an obsession with Batgirl in specific, because if he was trying to, you know, like overthrow Penguin sort of thing, you know, become that level, he'd be looking at the entire Bat family, especially Batman, but...
I wonder if
that's the thing, very is focused if, on Burnside itself.
Does he somehow know? Maybe if it is personal to Batgirl, though, does he know that Barbara's Batgirl and this whole try to date her as Barbara Gordon, is this just all to mess with her head so that when eventually he reveals his plan?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Because it feels like maybe he's targeting Burnside as a way of getting to her specifically. It's not all, but she's in my way of Burnside. He's come to Burnside for her.
I wonder if this will end up being like Detective, where Penguin ends up being the enemy of my enemy kind of thing. Where he's like, yeah, that little shit's up to no good, Batgirl.
Kind of felt like it could have been at the end of this, where he's like, come on, take a seat, let's talk the shit through.
Maybe how the next one starts.
That's what I'm thinking. If he can use all this tech to track superheroes, then that gives an edge to the supervillains. Because you know where they are and where they're not. Mm. You know? Mm. And Penguin might want to have a use for that, or he might not like that because he likes the old ways where you can just buy people off, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Actually, another page like this, when she's trying to concentrate and she's like doing the whole thing she did in the first arc where she's going into her mind room and she's trying to like focus to do that. I like that we get like a panel of her normal like focusing, then the next panel you see the buzzing of her phone, and then it's like the glass of the panel cracks in front of her. I thought it was a really nice touch. Yeah. It's like she's trying to like focus and then it breaks her focus.
It is literally breaking her concentration,
That was a nice moment. That was a nice way to show that Cap was jumping, hence the screen shaking. Audio listeners don't care, but for the, for the visual... audio listeners do care about that. Jeez. All right. That's Batgirl. Any final thoughts before we...
No, it's solid.
Yeah, it's solid. I'm still enjoying it. So, next up, Teen Titans issue 6, Benjamin Percy writing and Khoi Pham on the art. This is the start of a new arc, The Rise of Aqualad. I had a lot of fun with this issue. The Aqualad stuff is there, and it's good. It introduces him, it establishes that he's gay. I thought it was really interesting that his ex-boyfriend now, is more freaked out by him having powers and is almost like phobic about that. When he's a gay guy like who's too scared to commit to his father, I thought that was an interesting little swerve on that. But he's basically wanting to do more with his life and wants to do more with his powers, and he comes to Titan's Tower at the end of the issue. But the bulk of the issue, though, is that in the water in San Francisco, around San Francisco, where the Titan's Tower is. By the way, I love that they're the West Coast Titans. I think that's kind of funny. Yeah. As opposed to the other ones being in Manhattan. But there's people dying in the water, and fish dying in the water. Things are dying in the water. And it's on the news as shark attacks. And it turns out at the end of the issue that it's King Shark who's in the water, which I think is super fun. But I think the biggest thing, though, is that, again, it's the characters and their banter. It's Beast Boy, like, trying to make vegan food and the rest of them all rejecting it, and Wally going to get pizza. It's him arranging a news interview so that he can show this reporter around the building. And it's just...
Yeah, Beast Boy's such a, like... I don't want to say a prick, because he's not a jerk about things, but he's so just forceful. Like, in a way that Damien's not. Like, they're great, like, counterparts to each other.
It's funny. I think what makes this show work, though, is the way he describes all the other Titans, the way, he describes...
Yeah.
You know, like, he describes Damien as... what's the word he uses?
I have the issue in front of me.
Oh, I can't remember the word, but it was basically, he's annoyed at everything. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I love how he's playing a video game. He's playing Cheese Viking when they come in. But he goes around and he's describing all of them. He describes Starfire, he describes Raven's not very... Or Raven's super friendly, and it's like Raven's get out, and she bangs the
Leave
door.
Leave me alone, yeah. And then I love that Starfire, too. He's like, and this smoking hot babe is Starfire, and she's like, wait, smoking's bad, and especially for babies. I don't understand what you're saying. Yeah. Like, it was just, I thought that Percy's dialogue for all the Titans was good. The Aqualad stuff was a little, it felt off and just like, I don't want to say out of character because it's a new take on the character, but it was just so, like, the dialogue was kind of stilted, and
it
like,
was
between him and his mom. It's weird.
It was definitely a little bit more on the nose. I think that's maybe just down to trying to introduce all the key points of who he is in a couple of scenes before he... Because he comes to the Titans at the end of the issue. Maybe if he'd spread it out over a couple of issues. But then again, then we get to like the second issue of him being on his own with his own things and be like, why are we still doing this? Like, whereas here at the end, he arrives at the tower and it's like, okay, but now we can interrupt. Because I mean, ultimately, what we've seen from here, this is his backstory, this is his motivation.
Yeah.
But now that he's with... presumably going to be with the team in the next issue, we can see how he interacts with them. And I think the interaction's a big thing.
We saw he can waterbend, and he kind of can't really control it as much.
Mm.
So that's cool. And he's from New Mexico, where there's no ocean around, and that seems deliberate. Mom doesn't want to talk about the dad. So, like, everything is just... it's there. I just see in the dialogue.
Well, would you want to talk about your Atlantean one night stand?
No.
I don't know. She might want to brag about it every so often.
Yeah, true.
It was really fun. All the stuff with Beast Boy showing them around, and then of course at the end they want to go out and investigate, and they take out a boat that Kid Flash is driving, and Beast Boy's in the water, and he's like, right, Beast Boy, we're just up here. Well, if something comes for you, we're just here. He's like, aye, up in your dry boat. And it's at the end of the issue when he jumps back up and like King Shark's chasing him, and that's when they all realise it. Other favourite part, of course, is when the reporter arrives. We don't know it's a reporter. We just hear the alarms go off. It's like the system defences are all engaging because Damien's, you know, obviously got the place like covered in missiles and stuff.
Because of course he does.
Of course he does. Because you see all the big missile silos come up and like start pointing at things.
So that reminds me of a lot. I don't know if either you ever watched Teen Titans Go.
No.
It plays as a little comedy thing, and in that Robin, I'm pretty sure it's Tim, maybe? I can't remember, but he's super paranoid and over the top and really vigorous in everything, and the defenses like that go off over the top for the smallest thing. It'll be like a fly, and like six guns will come out of the side of the tower.
Yeah, so Damien goes out of character. He's like, Titans, go! And he chases out with them all behind him, and it just turns out to be a reporter. And Beast Boy's like, oh yeah, I forgot I arranged that for today. So, super amusing. Yeah.
Also, Beast Boy's responsibility for wanting to find her, because she was there because of him. I like that too. So, as much of a pushy prick he can be,
Because the reporter,
he still is a hero.
Yeah, the reporter gets shark attacked on her way home or whatever. Also, a couple of small points. They did set up, and I could have guessed this, but they don't actually know that he's Bruce Wayne's son, because they don't know his last name. Because someone says to him, why do you keep using our superhero names, even when we're just us? And he's like, because I'm professional. And then they ask, well, wait a minute, what is your last name anyway, Damien? And it's like, oh yeah, you can't tell them that, because then...
Do you know what? That's another beat from Teen Titans Go, where he always just goes by Robin, no matter what.
There you go. Super fun. I think Teen Titans is really bright and colourful, and the characters are all very poppy.
Yeah.
And I always look forward to reading it. It's always a nice, breezy, enjoyable read. It's kind of like, I'm not just saying this because they're both teen sort of characters, but like Super Sons kind of feels like that and this go perfect together. It's like in two different weeks, like you want those spread out because they kind of fill the same void on their respective weeks.
Yeah, so it's a little bit.
That's Teen Titans. That'll take us on to Batman Beyond issue 6, written by Dan Jurgens and art by Bernard Chang. And this is the start of a new arc. We have the League of Assassins are actually in this one in the future, and they're chasing after someone, as well as, although most of the issue is mainly Dana and Terry kind of like going over the whole thing, because Bruce is back in the cave and Bruce is like kind of grumpy that things have changed, but he's pretending not to be grumpy.
Bruce. Yeah. It's so great.
And Danny's like, oh, this is weird, I'm in the Batcave. I'm going to go, you've got all this stuff to do. I need to process you being Batman. I just found out you're alive, and also Batman. That's kind of weird. And he goes off, and we get this great thing where it's them, like, discussing everything on a rooftop, and he's like, no, I want to be... Like, I was so devoted to Batman, and Bruce taught me to do it his way, where it was Batman and nothing else. I couldn't tell anyone, I had to go it alone. Whereas now I've told all the people that are important to me, and I want to make time for me, time for Terry. And they almost kiss, and that's when Commissioner Barbara Gordon just gets the bat signal on when the assassins are attacking them, and they see the signal, and she's like, "Oh, I guess you have to go." And he's like, "No, I don't. I'll go in my time." So it's
don't mind the fact that the League of Assassins and Curare so the League of Assassins is chasing Curare, who goes to Commissioner Gordon for help because she knows they need Batman.
Yeah.
And they're having this fight, and Kiara is saving Barbara, and they can't get the bat signal plugged in, which I thought, you would think that it's always plugged in.
It's because he's been dead, like, Matt. To be fair, it's because he's been dead.
I understand that, but knowing what I know about big devices like that, they have a cable that goes into the grid. Because
they had a cover over it as well. It was like covered in a big tarp.
Yeah, and that's all you would need is the tarp and shut it off and... But,
yeah, there's no need to go and manually unplug the thing, is there?
Yeah, it's not an iPhone charger. Hey, although maybe in the future it is.
Hey, some people are really anal and unplug everything. At the end of the day, like every single device gets unplugged from the wall. Some people are really anal about it. I can say, maybe just
hit the main switch.
Yeah, the police department might just be really. Well, maybe that's all it is.
Well, again, it's the future. It's different, But yeah, I love that whole setup. That as Terry is having this conversation with Dana, his biggest ally needs help, and he's not going to be there because of personal reasons.
I liked it as well. I liked it. Well, he doesn't know what's going on, though. He doesn't know what the issue is.
No, of course not. Yeah. But this is kind of that scene from, all those detective movies. Like, picked a hell of a day to quit smoking. Picked a hell of a day to stop being Batman for the night.
I really like it because the scene with him and Dana is really, it feels really heartfelt, and it feels in character.
It feels real. Feels like a real conversation a couple would have.
And it's intercut with all the action on the police rooftop as they're fighting off the league. And you know that they're just about to get that signal on. They're trying their hardest to get that signal on while they're fighting with people. And they eventually get it on, and you see it light up between them. And you see them look off to the side, and she's like, oh, you have to go. And it almost seems like she's understanding. Like, I accept that you have to go. Like, there's something going down. And he, because he wants to make a promise that, no, that's not all my life is. I can do this as well. That can wait. And it's like, but look, Babs and Curare are kind of messed up on the roof right now. They kind of need you. A small point, Bruce mentions that the prototype suit that he's currently using is dangerous. It's a prototype, and if he doesn't know how to use it properly, it could end up killing him. So we'll see how that comes into play.
Yeah, that was a nice little wrinkle.
But Bruce knows that the Joker is around.
It's around,
from
the
last arc. And... We hear the police talking about how he was beat by a crowbar. It had to be someone he trusted,
right? Yeah. Someone close.
Yeah. So that was interesting.
Also, Bruce and Matt interacting is just great.
Oh yeah, just Joe, it's almost like it's like present day like mainline DC Bruce interacting with John, say, and he's asking all these questions, and he's being Yeah. That's what I felt like.
I enjoy the company of kids. Just tone it down. It's kind of like Schwarzenegger at the beginning of Kindergarten Cop, you know? Where he's kind of like, kids, I'm glad you're dealing with them. And then he gets pushed into it, so.
Yeah, no, so I think I've been surprised with Batman Beyond and how much I'm enjoying it.
Yep.
I kind of went into it like at the start of Rebirth thinking, it's kind of...
Well, that's why I asked this week if you're planning on covering it, because you did say you're going to get to the end of the first arc and then maybe trade weight it. So, you know.
But, no, I mean, I'm glad I read this issue. It was super fun.
It's good.
I mean, like I say, it's an easier one to trade weight because it isn't connected to the rest of the universe, so you don't feel like you're missing out on, like, proper parts of the world if you are skipping it. But if you do want some Batman Beyond stories, I think it's well worth checking out, whether it is single issues or trade. So, but anyway, that'll take us on to Deathstroke number 15, Christopher Priest writing and Carlo Pagulayan on art. Who read this?
We're talking about Deathstroke. Sorry, I had to check my phone.
Jesus, man. How unprofessional. How unprofessional is this?
I didn't. This was one of the couple of books I didn't get around to reading this week.
Yes, play Iron Fist.
Well, no, so just a disclaimer, I'm not being unprofessional. My cat's at the vet getting, you know, shots and a haircut.
Oh, I was just giving you
the primary phone number.
I was just giving you shit, Matt. I'm not being serious.
Okay, making sure. But no, I did read Deathstroke. So.
at least someone did.
Yes.
Hey, Matt, well, if anyone here can respect caring about your cat, it's me, all right?
Yeah, I mean, I think you should just leave it to fend for herself, but whatever.
Well, it's a cat. They do that anyways.
Exactly, so it'll be fine.
So anyways, yeah, I read Deathstroke, and the story's starting to come together again, although I say that every time. I think it's just Priest's way of seeding things.
How many times can one story come together, I wonder?
Well, this is what it is. He does this, where he seeds new things and then brings other things together in the same issue. So it always feels like there's something coming together, but in every issue, there's something new set up as well.
Yeah, so we left off on the last issue that Eddie Ann and Deathstroke are in a relationship, and Deathstroke is blind, and he's the worst father ever. And it left him with the new Power Girl, who I still can't remember her name, but... I'm just going to keep calling her the new Power Girl while all this is going. And they bring in Dr. Villain, or Wilhain, as they, you know, because he's French. You have to pronounce it that way. And he's, you know, shocked that the new Power Girl is only 16 and a half and is administering all of these medical tests. And she's like, yeah, but you're a doctor. He's like, I'm a geneticist. It's a little bit different. And so they come to find out that the reason that Deathstroke's gone blind is he was already having vision problems, and that was his healing factor was keeping it in check. Well, when he was in the nuclear reactor with Raptor, and his eyes were not protected, the radiation in the reactor kind of shut off his healing factor, and his eye vision or his eye problems jump started with his physiology. So the healing factor wasn't working. There wasn't anything really to heal. So he went blind. So he ends up working with Power Girl, and she gives him the sunglasses that kind of allows him to see, kind of via sonar, kind of. So he's kind of like Daredevil.
Yeah, I was going to say, it sounds like a Daredevil knockoff.
And she ends up having this retired police dog. Then... there's a bit of tension between Deathstroke and the dogs. The dog doesn't trust him. As well, you shouldn't. Nobody should trust Deathstroke.
Bit of tension between him and the dog.
Yeah. Well, there is, and it's played for laughs because the dog's growling at him and he can't see. And so he doesn't know what kind of dog it is.
I can imagine him snarling back.
Yeah, right. Well, he's like, he tells her, basically, silence the dog or lose the dog. So he's like, he's willing to you know, just end this dog for growling at him. At the same time, you have Joey dealing with his problems and kind of freaking out that he killed Dr. Icon. And so he's trying to put that together. Rose calls him and, you know, they're doing the brother-sister thing and talking about the wedding. And she's like, yo, I don't trust your your wife-to-be. There's something that's off about her, and I think she's working for your mom. And he's like, oh, no, that could never happen. If anything, she's working with my dad. And so it kind of plays into that, that Joey's picking up on these things. Like, he's not just a fool, but we don't know what her motivations exactly are at this point in time. But Power Girl and Deathstroke end up at this event that they're supposed to go to where she's going to meet a congresswoman. Turns out there's a hit on her. Another assassin's there. Deathstroke ends up being able to, you know, kind of neutralize him. But the assassin's pissed off that Deathstroke's there because it's a violation of their, like, assassin's rules. Like, Deathstroke wasn't supposed to be in this place in time, and he can't swoop in and get the kill. But Deathstroke's just there to attend. And when this assassin, who's known as the most dangerous man, shows up and makes this grand entrance, Deathstroke's there as this new hero called Twilight with the dog. And
so that's where the name of the arc comes from.
That's where the name of the dog is. That throughout the whole issue, Power Girl's like, yeah, you're a hero, you just don't know it. And he's like, no, hero villains, that's a fake thing. And she's like, no, I think you're a superhero. So here's your costume. He's like, it's a uniform. And it's just him grumpy dealing with the 16-year-old. So at the end, we get him and the dog as this hero team taking out this assassin for the next issue. But the real interesting stuff was the Joey and Rose. And Rose is getting ready to join back up and leave her family.
Oh, she's finally coming home.
Yep. And the guy that wants her protection wants to marry her so Slade won't kill him for putting a hit out on him or ratting on him. Wants to go with. He's just like, no, you have to stay here. So I almost would want just a whole arc of just Rose and seeing what she does after this. But yeah, that's where stuff starts to come together. So you start getting the, oh, you're a hero thing. And then at the end, he is masquerading as a hero. But
yeah,
glad I'm still reading this one. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, we didn't mention in the news, but it looks like this is shipping down to once monthly instead of twice.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
might make it easier to keep track of, if that's the thing.
Yeah, too. That's happened with Cyborg. They've not made an official announcement, though. It's just in the June solicits, it's just one issue. So
yeah, I think that's how it happened with Cyborg, though, isn't it?
It is, yeah. So obviously, we could get... But it did happen 1 month with... I think Harley only had, like, one month. And I think it. Maybe Suicide. So it could go back to two.
So yeah, it could be just catching up.
Yeah. But so there's precedent for both. There's precedent for it just going single. There's precedent for it going back to double after.
It's one of those weird books where it's clearly selling enough that it's kept... It can't be selling that badly because it's kept double shipping up for, what, 9 months by that point.
Well, and the Chicago issue put a spotlight on it. I know that was pretty high selling. Like, they made a big deal to push that. Mm. So... But I mean,
at the same time, it's not like an amazing seller. But if it went down to once monthly, I think they could see go. Yeah,
it might actually help it. So
it might. Yeah,
I mean, maybe they want Priest on another book that's coming up. Maybe so it's like, okay, we'll put this as one a month, and we can do one a month of another book. That's a single.
Oh, I'd really hope so.
That'd be nice.
It's going to one a month. Is that during the Lazarus contract?
No, monthly
after.
After, okay. So yeah, maybe whatever happens in Lazarus doesn't need, you know, they don't need it to double ship anymore. Maybe they're freeing that spot for something else, maybe like Titans or Teen Titans to double ship, you know?
Not in June, but I wouldn't say no to either of those double shipping, honestly. Having fun.
Titans feels like it should be, and not to go on a jag, but just...
It does.
That's one book I feel that should be double shipping. Deathstroke doesn't need it, you know?
I think that's just a case of Abnett being busy, because obviously Aquaman, that does double ship.
Oh, swap. Put Aquaman on one a month, and put
I'd also make that call every time. Yeah, but Aquaman as a single solitary hero technically is higher ranked than the Titans, I suppose.
I get it. I might try and give Aquaman another chance actually, because Sedgwick's going to start doing the art come June, and his art is pretty spectacular. So I'll give it a try. I'll maybe read the trade of the. Whatever arc we gave up on and see if it was better in binge form.
Oh, well, you let us know.
Yeah. Like his art is great and I'd love to read it, but not at the I couldn't get through the story. I was just bored.
And until the Seven Seas starts, I'm checked out.
I'm just hoping it reads better in bulk, and it might. I don't know, because some books do. But, no, so there you go. That's Deathstroke. That'll take us on to Hal Jordan and the Green Lantern Corps, number 17. Robert Venditti writing and Ethan Van Sciver on art. Connor is the sole survivor of this book, so take it away.
Hey, it's been better in general. You know, it's been pretty good. This is mostly dealing with the aftermath of the last issue with Guy kind of being very beat up and Arkelo being taken to the cells with the other renegade yellows. And Guy talks about his logic was basically prison rules, where you go in, you beat up the toughest guy there and prove that, no, you follow my commands here. And that's basically it. It's his way of putting all the yellows in line, going, look, I can take out your boss with my bare hands.
That is the most Guy Gardner thing you can do.
It does sound like Guy. It sounds very Guy.
I love it.
It is, and I really appreciated that. And he knocked out one of Arkelo's teeth, one of the big fangs, and he gets given that as a trophy when he wakes up. But he goes and visits him in the cell, and he gives it him back, and he goes, look, I'm sure Saronic can reattach this, so here you go. And he goes, I'm looking forward to working with you. Because obviously that's the kind of thing at the minute where they're all teaming up, and he goes, all right, now that I've commanded your respect, essentially, he thinks that Arkelo will be like, fine, I'll grudgingly accept this and work with you. And once he follows, all the other yellows that are holding out will as well, is his logic. Which is, that was pretty enjoyable. I'm digging the Guy stuff here. And there's a good bit of banter where they're all in, he's like in a hospital bed, basically, and all the Earth Lanterns are there, the other three, and obviously John's the leader of the Corps now, so he's kind of giving him a bit of a lecture. And Hal's like, yeah, if he starts going off on you, just pretend to fall asleep. It'll be fine. Yeah. So it's kind of fun in that sense. It's really nice having all the lanterns together again and just having banter. Because I think that's what, like, before this run, Venditti stuff suffered from most, is when Hal was just off on his own. And Hal is obviously the weakest part of his entire cast.
Yeah.
So that was the weakest part.
Here's a question, though. So the front cover of this book has Kyle in his Green Lantern uniform.
I was just about to get to that.
I'm deeply curious as to this.
Yeah, so that stuff with Guy takes up most of the front half of the issue. And then the back half is this. So the Guardians call up Kyle up to their little floating platform that they've got above Mogo. And St. Walker's there. And they're like, okay, we want you to do something. And Kyle has a bit of a chat with Hal, and they talk about how he's the only person to ever master all the emotions and become the White Lantern. He's the only one ever. And Hal says it's because he can create, and it's really hinting that he can create life, or at least another core or something. And Hal's talking about how he thinks Kyle is the greatest Lantern of all, because even though he is the best green and he can do things that no one else can do in the way he's connected to the willpower, Kyle can do things that no one can do with all of them. So he gets up there and the Guardians are like, right, we're going to do this thing with St. Walker and you're here and we're going to do this resurrection. That's what they call it. And they touch and there's this white lightning that comes out of Kyle and it spreads into this off Mogo. You see it shoot into space, this massive just white lightning bolt. And then something goes wrong, seemingly. It just stops. It shorts out. And Kyle's just there on the floor. His white uniform is just gone. And this is where we get a tease of things in the rest of the universe. So we've got one bit of the Redlands. You've got just them raging because that's what they do.
That's what they do.
Yeah
red exactly.
Rages, yes.
Yeah, but then it gets more interesting. So you have one of Flash, and he just says, something's not right. So seeing as this was talking about resurrection, I wonder if this plays into the ending of the issue of Flash that we just had.
Are you thinking this is to do with Eobard?
I am wondering. I am wondering, because it's very. There's only three panels of this bit. We'll get to the third one in a second. But there's only three panels here. The red's kind of, okay, that makes sense to you know, have that stuff in there. But Flash, it's very specific timing, this, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah, but I don't know that page, because you let us know about this before.
Yeah.
With the Flash, there's blue and hope all over it.
Well, yeah, I wonder if that was just a nod to his
blue ring.
Blue ring. Yeah.
Time and Blackest Night. I could see that.
Yeah. But I mean, with the stuff with Eobard talking about, you know, remembering Flashpoint, how because he died in Flashpoint.
Right.
I wonder if this is a not quite a literal resurrection, but a resurrection of that personality, a resurrection of those memories.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not too sure, but we'll see where that goes. And the third one is, I think it's the first time this book has overtly played into Rebirth. We see Mr. Oz watching, presumably this, because we see Kyle there on one of his monitors, and he just says so many questions. Like, this is beyond even him, is what it looks like.
Hmm.
Which is very interesting.
Yes. Yeah.
But then, after all that, his ring, white ring, splits into the seven original rings, and they fly off to find replacements. But the green ring comes back to him, and he becomes just a Green Lantern again. Which obviously you knew was going, because it was on the front cover. But
well, that's good.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is cool. I like Kyle.
I mean, still my least favourite of the Lanterns of those four, but whatever.
Better than Guy.
No.
Come on.
Guy follows prison rules. That's it.
Well, it's a good job I know what Matt respects if I ever have to go into a fight with him.
I'm just saying, like, you find the biggest guy, you take him out, nobody messes with you. I get it. Like,
yeah, it works, doesn't it?
Yeah. And I get why people don't like Guy, but, like, we have five really great Human Lanterns. And I feel like Hal, who used to be my favorite, has taken a turn for the worse. So, you know, you can make an argument for any of the Earth ones.
The thing with Guy is when he's like this, he's just a lot of fun to read.
Yeah.
It's very enjoyable, and it's hard not to have fun with that.
Yep.
So it makes it a really nice read when he's there doing this stuff.
Where's my Kilowog ongoing? That's what I want to know.
Oh, you're a Wog guy, huh?
He's not my favorite.
He's training up some of the rookie yellows, getting them up to scratch.
You gotta get those poosers in line.
Exactly.
Hey, that's actually not a bad idea for a book. You do like a school book where he's training these yellow lanterns, and you call it Kilowog and the Sinestro Corps.
Do you know what I'd actually love is a spin-off series of, like, every issue, or even if you do an arc, you pick a different team. Like what Green Lantern Corps could be, really. And
yeah, we'll see. That was
partnership.
When Tomasi was writing it, that was kind of where it was before he took over.
Yeah.
But it was just around Guy. It was kind of Guy's book, and it was different elements of the Corps. And I liked it a lot. And then Tomasi got his hands on it, and I liked it even more, but yeah, I could definitely see that. Just a GLC book that did that.
Yeah, and in this case, each arc or each issue focus on one green and one yellow pairing and go, right, this is their whatever mission they're on. It doesn't have to be a big, massive missions, but just have fun with that.
Yeah. It could almost not even need to have its own kind of like long form, like ongoing story. They could all be kind of standalone.
Anthologies.
Yeah. Because you've got your other Green Lantern books, you can use them to do your big long things and whatnot. There you go. But that's the last book. That's we got through it. So that's all this week's books. That leads us on to picking our favourite stuff of the week, and that is panel, art, cover, and our top five books. So let's start with panel, as we always do. I was conflicted between two choices here. I was tempted by the Crime Square sort of bright lights backgrounds of Detective. However, I'm actually going with Batgirl. I just want the panel of the little girl holding up the bit of paper that says, "Are they listening to us?" Because it really made me laugh. I laughed out loud, and I don't often laugh out loud at a comic. They'll make me smile, I'll be amused, but that made me laugh out loud. So that gets it for the humour this week. Connor, what's your favourite panel of the week?
Mine is the showdown between Cass and Sciver with the white background.
All the
Sciver just wailing on her. All the moves.
Yeah.
Technically still one panel because nothing splits them up.
That is true. That is true.
I mean, I know we stretch it all the time anyway, but time I'm sticking to the definition.
Do you know what it looks like, though? It reminds me of, like, an old versions of, like, Windows when you'd have, like, clip art pop up. You just have all the clip art things. It looks like a bunch of clip art options, almost.
It does, now,
all the different moves.
But I just love that whole sequence of what it is and how it looks and the way it plays in where it is in the book. And it's like this break and everything just focuses in on this.
Yeah. Matt.
So mine is Superman Reborn, where he is reborn with Lois, and John is so stoked his parents are back.
Are we talking about the splash page where he gets the new suit, or before then when he?
Yep. The splash page where he gets the new suit, and you see them, and they're flying back, you know, from Mixie's.
Why am I not surprised Matt picked this?
No.
Oh, I'm so shocked.
It's easy. I know. It's a good moment. I get Superman back properly. He'll be back in Metropolis soon, doing what needs to be done, you know.
Yeah. All right, best cover, Connor. What's your best cover of the week?
Action Comics. This is an easy one. I've been waiting the whole crossover just for this for this issue to take the best cover, because look at it.
All right, Matt.
This one was hard because this week is, you know, kind of difficult, but I really like the Flash, where it looks like Boomerang is getting ready to give a torture rack to old Flasher.
He's got Flash up on across his shoulders, sort of.
Yeah.
Back down, yeah. I was kind of the same boat as Matt. I thought they were all decent covers this week, but nothing was like sticking out to me as, oh, that is definitely my pick. I settled on Batgirl, actually, though. I like her sneaking in at night, and it's like, you know, creepy, and like penguins like there behind
looking
her.
Looking down on it. Yeah.
It's just a fun image. It's not the best cover ever, but I think for me this week it takes the victory. So best art of the week, Matt. You can start us on this one.
I'm gonna go with Wonder Woman. Just based off of the stuff with Ferdinand, and then at the end, the shock of her getting taken out by the sniper, and everything else through there with Dr. Sciver and her expressions and some of the stuff she turns into. It's a whole lot of fun.
It's hard to fault picking Liam Sharp. I'm not going to do it this week myself, but it's hard to fault that choice because he's won it for me a few times at this point, I'm not sure. I was a little conflicted. I was really tempted to go with Teen Titans. I love the art style in that. I think Khoi, Pham's done a great job at making a really fun poppy book. But I think I'm actually going to go with Action on this one. I think Doug Mahnke.
Yeah.
There are a lot of great stuff. John's fear and then happiness, and you know, obviously that page where they're flying back, and he's like, "You saved the day, Superboy. You lead the way." Stuff like. All great stuff. And Mixie's facial expressions, of course, as well. So manic and trail-like. It's good stuff. So I'm going with Action on that. Connor?
I'll be going with Hal Jordan, Green Lantern Corps. I think Fad Skyver kills it. We all know he can do action sequences fantastically, because that's no surprise. But in this one, he really nails all the small little beats of the banter and the just the facial movements and stuff. And it impressed me. I didn't know he could do it quite that well.
I'll take us out of top five. Before we actually get to the top five, I do want to just cover up some things from last week, because we were debating, especially once Matt had left. Matt did indeed pick the same book as us, so was it Nightwing last week we all picked?
Yeah.
Yeah, so Nightwing was unanimous, but it was the second unanimous, because as Connor did correctly say, Matt actually did change his pick on that week with Deathstroke 11. So we've had two unanimous picks this year so far. Deathstroke 11 and Nightwing 19. I have to think about that. 19. So we've had two unanimous picks in 2017 in 3 months, which is still pretty slim. We were doing it more often than that last year. So I feel like when we get to the end of the year and we have a list of unanimous, it'll be a nice short, you know.
I think it's safe to say at this point there'll be less than 10.
Probably. I mean, things could really start syncing up later. But especially as we get more events and big things happening that are maybe more, you know, obvious picks, but...
Yeah.
All right, top fives. Matt, top five books of the week.
So, number one for me this week is Action Comics with the Rebirth. Or the Reborning. I don't want to say Rebirth, but Superman. Everything's set back to where it should be. Number two is Wonder Woman. Fantastic. Three, Detective. Four is Deathstroke. And five's Batgirl.
I don't even think the bookies were taking bets on match number one. They were just refusing.
It was such an obvious one. I was like, we're not losing money on that.
Yeah, we're turning that down at the door. No, we're not accepting bets on Action Comics being match number one.
That's Roman Reigns going over at WrestleMania odds right there. You don't bet against it.
I love how Matt, like, once a week they'll drop a wrestling reference just to confuse Carl.
I have to.
I think he does it just so he knows that I have to sit here with a blank face and can't react. It's like, well, yeah,
it's
sure.
not that.
Yeah,
it's...
I get that.
The amount of time I spend between watching wrestling and listening to wrestling podcasts during the week, it just bleeds in. Especially right now, it's the big time. So,
Connor, what's your top five of the week?
Well, I'm going to start by saying, sorry, Matt, this is not going to be a unanimous one for action. Because
Ginger Menace.
As we talked about, it was a great issue, but it didn't do anything to blow me away because it was what we expected. So first is Detective. But Action will be second. Third will be Wonder Woman. Fourth, Batgirl. And fifth, Hal Jordan.
Cool. Unfortunately, Matt, it's not even going to be two for Action because I'm going Detective number one.
I expected that out of you. I'm not upset.
Wait, why am I expecting Detective and he's not?
Because you brought up the cast stuff. Okay. I know you're a real big fan. Of Cassie Kane and Shiva, so...
I only read the first Cassie trade a couple of weeks ago now, but I did like it a lot. Yeah, it was really good.
But you were big on her since Tynion added her to...
Oh, yeah, sure, sure. She's been great since the start of this run. Like, all her stuff with... I've sent up her secret weapon and the elevator just opened and it was her. Like,
yeah.
I think that was the issue where Tim, you know, quote-unquote died at the end. I think that was that issue.
Yeah.
But all that stuff's great. But anyway, now Detective number one, it feels like the stakes are really rising and because of that, it's hard not to get really invested. Number two, yeah, probably Action. I'm going to go Flash at number three, Wonder Woman at number four and Teen Titans at number five. Hard to fault this week though, because that just leaves Batgirl and Batman Beyond off for me, and I'm both enjoying both of those as well. So,
yeah, it was a real. You know, it's a solid week when me and Matt. I don't think either of us had Flash in our top fives, and that was a very good issue.
It's just this is what Rebirth's been doing, and I say this like at least once a month, where everything's solid. Like some stuff rises to the top more than others, but it feels good to be reading this much DC.
Yeah. I feel weird not having Batgirl in my top five, but no, it just got slightly outclassed for me. With I think Flash just slightly nudged it, but nah. I think I'm just excited by Thorn. I'm just excited by Reverse Flash at the end. I think that's what that is.
Yeah.
Just that core excitement. So yeah, that's all our favourite stuff of the week. That leads me to tell you what's coming in next week's show. This is a short list, so don't worry about it. So we have Batgirl Annual Issue 1, we have The Titans Annual Issue 1, and we have Justice League of America Issue 3. So we have three books next week. So there'll be a bit of extra time for talking about other stuff and rambling on and maybe getting to some questions and that kind of thing. I'm looking forward to the Batgirl Annual, though, because that's Batgirl and Supergirl teaming up.
Kicking off the Legion story.
Which leads into the Supergirl arc, yeah, where they're going to be trapped in the Phantom Zone together. Oh. So good.
Yeah. I was going to say, it should give us a nice taste of what to expect from that.
Yeah. And Titans is them working with their mentors, which should be cool. So, it should be a fun week next week.
I hope Nightwing works with Superman. That would be so great.
Wait, why is Superman there? There's not a Superman equivalent on the team. Yeah. It's all of the direct... Like, you get Nightwing, so Batman's there. You got Flash.
I know that, but I was making that Superman is just as much as Dick Grayson's mentor as Bruce. So I was making a Batman dig.
All right, it fell flat. I'm sorry, Matt. I didn't get it.
That's fine.
I think we're just being hopeful.
No.
Oh, well. So that should be fun. I don't want to dwell on it, but I did want to just mention there was a Justice League trailer today. Now, we're not going to talk about it because none of us have watched it yet.
I figured you two would have.
No, neither of us give a shit enough to actually watch it.
So, you know, I did see a couple of they were doing those like 15-second like character teases the last couple of days. I'd seen a couple of them on Twitter.
I hate everything I've seen. Ugh, I just hate it.
I hate that Flash outfit so much. I hate it so much.
As a Superman fan, it really pisses me off that he's not part of any of the marketing. Well,
this was the thing. You know? They revealed like a different part of the big poster, like each day with each character, right? And they revealed the full thing with five characters on it. There's five characters on the main poster for the first ever live-action Justice League movie. One of them is Cyborg, and none of them are Superman or Green Lantern.
Do you know what? I'm at a point where I can live with Cyborg being there because they've done.
Not over seven years.
But not instead of Superman and Green Lantern.
If you're doing a Mount Rushmore of superheroes, Superman, Batman, Spider-Man, and Wolverine, that's it. Like those are four of the most iconic superheroes, and yet you're gonna build a whole movie with the absence of one of those, where pretty. Big character, like that's like X-Men without Wolverine. You know, like if they're the first time the X-Men come together, Wolverine's not there. It's weird.
And if you're only going to have five characters in Justice League, you don't have Aquaman either. I mean, I like Aquaman's fine and all, but if you're going to have five, then the fifth character is Green Lantern. Like,
What's the point in a Justice League movie with? What's the point without having that Flash and Green Lantern relationship?
I know, it's so stupid.
And where's the banter supposed to come from?
And people are going to say, yeah, but of course Superman's not there because this happened in the last movie. Well, that was stupid doing that in the movie right before Justice League.
Do you know what's worse about it? Is we know he did that just because of Justice League coming up. I
will fight anybody because I have the video proof. There was that interview right after BVS came out where he said he did it. And it's like he was defending himself as if he was in court.
I think he said, "If Superman was there, he'd want to be the leader, and I didn't want to have to find a way to make him not the leader because I wanted Batman to be the leader. So I just killed him." That's what he said.
Spoilers for Batman v Superman.
I don't even feel bad.
I don't even.
If you were listening to a DC Comics podcast, you've probably seen it.
Okay, sure, but still.
You deserve to have a spoiler because it's shit and you don't deserve it doesn't deserve a spoiler warning.
We danced around it effectively up until that point.
And I got sick of it. That film does not deserve that courtesy.
It's shit. Batman v Superman is terrible. We've got like a 2+ hour review swearing a lot about it.
My wife is like, "We're going to watch that trailer right now?" I said, "No, I'm eating breakfast. Like, I'm not ruining breakfast. Not ruining my day."
I don't even know if I'll actively go out of my way to watch it. I think it'll just be... I'll eventually see it at some point anyway because it'll come on in front of a movie or be on the TV or whatever. But
I was trying to find a way to make you see it so I don't have to. Yeah. But I'm going to have to.
Do you know what? I am strangely looking forward to how cathartic the review is going to be, though.
It's going to feel good to just have a... place to focus all that hate.
Well, 2 hours. As of right now, it's Snyder's last DC movie, so that's one thing to be excited about.
Because
he's not getting a part two.
Do you know what bugs me about people who seem to like the DC movies and Snyder is they talk about how, and even people who don't like his movies because they think the writing's terrible, they talk about how, oh, he's a great visual director. And I don't think he is. I think his movies look like shit. I hate how, like...
I don't think... They don't all look like shit, but they have...
The best part of Sucker Punch were the visuals, because, right?
Like,
that movie did not have a story.
No, it was terrible. I hate Sucker Punch.
Yeah.
But
I know, but what I'm saying, though, but the best part are the visuals.
Sure.
He gets that at least one thing
right. I don't know.
Right.
I don't know if I would agree with that, even though. I think his movies all have this really, really shitty fake CG look to them. Even, like, everyone was freaking out because the Batman teaser for the Justice League trailer, right, had him on top of a gargoyle, and this is the Batman image I wanted in my life, and all the rest of it. And I'm like, but it looks like shit. I put up a screenshot from Batman Begins of Batman on a building, right, just sitting there with his cape flowing, and I'm like, this is what night looks like. Night looks like this. And this shot of Batman in the Justice League trailer...
You put that shot with Wonder Woman's terrible guitar riff, and it assaults all your senses.
It does. Because it's just a shit CG background. It doesn't feel real. It doesn't feel like they're actually out at night. I don't have a problem with scenes being set at night. Nights looks great if you shoot it properly, but this is all fake night. This is fake CG night and green screen, and it looks bad and murky.
I liked his visual style in Watchmen. I think it worked for that.
Yeah, it's a darker movie, yeah. though. It kind of...
Yeah, that's what I mean. It worked for that, and so it was playing to his strengths. But
Billy
Crudup's
blue
clearly...
wing just hanging out all over the place.
Yeah, I don't know. We're on a bit of a hate fest here at the end.
We got to stop
but
doing
that's
this.
Because we are a DC Comics podcast, and we're all big fans of these characters.
We just care and too much.
Yeah.
One of the biggest comic book movies of all time is coming out, and not one of us is excited. That's a problem.
And also, Batman's got a new suit where the suit's more black, and then the logo's silver. And I'm like, that just reminds me of the final suit from Batman and Robin with George Clooney. Like, what are you doing to
me? I don't know why they changed the suit at all. The one he had in the last movie was fine.
Because there was blood all over that one.
Well, Alfred can dry clean.
Alfred doesn't dry clean. He's a mechanic in these movies.
Don't get me wrong. I would have taken maybe taller years a little bit. I'd have liked some taller years.
Tweaks.
Right. Maybe slim it down a bit. It was a little bit too bulky on him. But other than that, yeah, the suit was fine otherwise.
Yeah.
So Matt's been shooed off by his wife because it's his anniversary.
Yeah.
So we'll wrap this up.
Yeah.
But I'm sure you enjoy getting the hate out, though, before we die.
I do.
Wound. But no, so that's Justice League trailer came out. The fact that we didn't rush to see the new Justice League trailer tells you how we feel about these movies right now. So there we go. That has been the DC Comics podcast from us. That is Comics from the Multiverse. Let us know what you thought of this week's books in the comments below if you're on YouTube or elsewhere. You can get us on Twitter at mailed_fuzz, which will also give you channel updates for the YouTube channel. Plus, obviously, our individual Twitters are on the screen. But for the audio people, I'm at Wibble89. Connor's at ConnorRyan94. Matt is at MattOfSteel57. You can get us there for just ramblings and the stuff we say. And usually me complaining about how bad Zack Snyder movies look. I was doing that a lot this week.
That is like half of your tweets.
It probably is at this point. But, so yeah, get us on there. Like and subscribe and all that stuff. Give us a 5-star rating if you're on iTunes or SoundCloud or like is whatever. Whatever the positive button is on the device or the service you're using, give us the positive button. Thank you. But that's us, guys. Thank you very much for watching and or listening. We'll be back next time with a more chatty podcast because, let's face it, only 3 books means time for shenanigans. So thank you very much for watching. We will see you next time. And always remember, never get lost in the Speed Force.
Long live the Legion.